Dear student, today I am going to discuss on the topic of structured labor. First of all, we should know definition of obstructed labor. Obstructed labor is the one where, in spite of good uterine contraction, the progressive descent of the presenting part is arrested due to mechanical obstruction. This may result either due to factor in the fetus or in the birth canal or both. The prevalence is about 1 to 2% in the referral hospital. Next, come to the causes of obstructed labor. It may be due to fault in passage or fault in passenger. Fault in passage means fault in mother pelvis. It include bony or soft tissue obstruction. In bony, it may be due to contracted pelvic or cephalopelvic disproportion. Soft tissue obstruction include cervical dystocia due to prolapse or previous operative scar, broad ligament fibroid, impacted ovarian tumor, the non-gravid horn of bicornate uterus below the presenting part. Fault in passenger. Fault in passenger means fault in fetus, which include transverse lie, bro presentation, congenital malformation of fetus like hydrocephalus, which is most commonest, fetal ascites, double monster, big baby, occipito posterior position, compound presentation, or lock twin. During obstruction, there will be anatomical changes in uterus and bladder. In uterus, there is formation of Bandel's rings, which is also called pathological retraction ring. During obstruction, obstructed labor, there is a gradual increase in intensity, duration and frequency of uterine contraction. The relaxation phase become less and less. Ultimately, a state of tonic contraction develop. A circular groove encircling the uterus is formed between the active upper segment and the distended lower segment called pathological retraction ring. In primary gravida, further retraction ceases in response to obstruction and later come to a stand, ever comes to a standstill, state of uterine exhaustion. But in multipara, retraction continues with progressive circumferential dilatation and thinning of lower segment. There is progressive rise of Bandel's ring, moving nearer and nearer to the umbilicus, and ultimately the lower segment rupture. Anatomical changes in bladder. The bladder becomes an abdominal organ, and due to compression of urethra between the presenting part and symphysis pubis, during obstruction, the base of the bladder and urethra, which are nipped in between the presenting part and symphysis pubis, may undergo pressure necrosis. The tissue become infected and later on may slough off, resulting in the development of genitourinary fistula. Bladder wall get traumatized and that result in blood stain urine. Now come to the effect on mother due to obstructed liver. First, exhaustion is due to constant agonizing pain and anxiety. Dehydration is due to increased muscular activity without adequate fluid intake. Metabolic acidosis is due to accumulation of lactic acid and ketones. Genital sepsis is an invariable accompaniment, especially after rupture of membrane, with repeated vaginal examination or attempted manipulation outside. Injury to genital tract include rupture of the uterus, which may be spontaneous in multipara or may be traumatic following instrumental delivery, postpartum hemorrhage and shock. It may be due to isolated or combined effect of atonic uterus or genital tract trauma. All this leads to increased maternal morbidity and mortality. Remote complication include genitourinary fistula or rectovaginal fistula, variable degree of vaginal atresia, secondary amenorrhea following hysterectomy due to rupture or due to Sehan syndrome. Effect on fetus. Asphyxia result from tonic uterine contraction that interfere with the uteroplacental circulation or due to cord prolapse, especially in shoulder presentation. Acidosis due to fetal asphyxia and maternal acidosis. Intracranial hemorrhage is due to supermolding of the head leading to tentorial tear or due to traumatic delivery. Infection all leads to increased perinatal loss. Clinical features in case of obstructed liver. Patient is in the agony from continuous pain and discomfort and become restless. Feature of exhaustion and ketoacidosis on abdominal palpation. Upper segment is hard and tender. Lower segment is distended and tender. Distended bladder on vaginal examination. Vulva usually swollen and edematous. Dry vagina, hot and occasionally offensive and purulent discharge. Cervix is almost fully dilated or hanging like curtain. The presenting part is extremely molded and jammed in the pelvis. There will be large caput formation. Now come to the management of obstructed liver. First of all, how you prevent obstructed liver? During antenatal period, antenatal detection of the factor that likely to produce prolonged liver, like big baby, small woman, malpresentation and position. During intranatal, continuous vigilance, use of partograph and timely intervention of a prolonged liver due to mechanical factors can prevent obstructed liver. Failure in progress of liver in spite of good uterine contraction for a reasonable period, 2 to 4 hours, is an impending sign of obstructed liver. Now come to the actual treatment of obstructed liver. We should first relieve the obstruction by delivering the baby either vaginally or abdominal route. Second, combat dehydration and ketoacidosis. And third, to control sepsis. When patient came in obstetric level, we all know that patient is dehydrated and there will be sign of ketoacidosis. First of all, we should give IV fluid and correct dehydration and ketoacidosis. At least 3 liters of fluid is required to correct clinical dehydration. A vaginal swab is taken and sent for culture and sensitivity test. Blood sample is sent for group and cross matching, and a bottle of blood should be at hand prior to any operative intervention. You should give antibiotic like ceftriaxone 1 gram IV, or IV infusion of metronidazole is given for anaerobic infection. Now come to the obstetric management. Before proceeding for definitive operative treatment, rupture of the uterus must be excluded. We have to deliver baby either vaginal route or cesarean section. There are some indication of vaginal delivery. We deliver baby by forceps or destructive procedure. When we apply forceps, we apply forceps in obstructed level in alive fetus with head less than 1/5 above pelvic brim, means head should be well engaged or there will be mild or moderate molding. Destructive procedure should be done in dead fetus, congenitally malformed baby like hydrocephalus. The cervix should be fully dilated with no evidence of rupture or imminent rupture. After completion of delivery and expulsion of the placenta, exploration of uterus and the lower genital tract should be done to exclude uterine rupture or tear. Now, there are some indications of cesarean delivery in obstructed level. Fetus should alive with incomplete cervical dilatation or high station of presenting part. Alive fetus with brow or face presentation. Third one, alive or dead fetus with evidence of imminent uterine rupture, and dead fetus with unmet criteria for obstructive or instrumental delivery. Now come to the post-operative care and follow-up in case of obstructed labor. We should intensive resuscitation and monitoring of patient should be continued till condition improve. Puerperal sepsis is almost inevitable, so antibiotic IV is given till fever free for 2 to 3 days and continue courses postoperatively. Close monitoring to identify complication early like peritonitis, abscess formation. Bladder drainage for 5 to 7 days, blood transfusion if needed. Investigation include blood and urine culture sensitivity as indicated. Analgesics should be given. Breast care for those with stillbirth or neonatal death, fistula care and follow-up. Women with fistula are kept in the hospital until the infection controlled. They should be informed about when and where can they have the fistula repair. Usually the fistula repair is undertaken 2 to 3 months after delivery. It's all about obstructive labor. Thank you, student.